Spoštovana gospa ministrica, vaša ekscelenca gospod veleposlanik, spoštovani gostje, dobrodošli na mednarodni konferenci o okoljski odgovornosti v Ljubljani. Dear Madam Minister, Your Excellency, Mr. Ambassador, dear distinguished guests, welcome at the International Conference on Environmental Liability in Ljubljana, Slovenia. Because we have mostly Slovenian guests, we will conduct our conference mostly in Slovenian, but I'll start with English to give you some technical information. So, because we will speak mainly Slovenian and of course also English, we will provide a direct translation from English to Slovenian and vice versa from Slovenian to English, so you may use your headphones for that. And then one more important thing, we would like to give you as much quality information when you go back to your institutions, to your countries. So we provided a very special service which is called graphic recording, and we have a big expert on that. This is Ms. Josephine from Germany. She lives in Vienna, and that's her first impression, so the first slide. She will be a sort of graphic reporter, and she will also note in this very funny but really, really spectacular way the keynotes you can then take back to your home. Večinoma bomo govorili tukaj slovensko, glede na to, da imamo največ slovenskih udeležencev, imamo pa tudi nekaj posebnih servisov. Eno je seveda prevod iz slovenščine v angleščino in obratno za vse tiste, ki bi želeli v slovenščini poslušati tudi prezentacije. Imamo pa tudi posebno, recimo temu, grafično reporterko, Josephine, ki živi na Dunaju, sicer Nemka, specialistka za takšno simpatično slikanje. Ona bo v bistvu na ta način tudi izbirala pomembne točke današnjega srečanja, ki jih boste potem lahko tudi v takšni obliki vzeli domov. Dogodek tudi neposredno prenaša Slovenska tiskovna agencija prek svojega video servisa. Prav tako dogodek neposredno prenašajo tudi prek Facebook strani organizatorja dogodka. Just one more small remark, the event is live broadcast by the Slovenian Press Agency on its designated website and of course via Facebook Live service of the website of the event. Prva govornica današnjega dne pa je direktorica podjetja TaxFinLex in vodja projekta EcoLex Live, gospa Zlata Tavčar, glavna organizatorka tega dogodka in tudi tista oseba, ki je najbolj zaslužena za to, da bo ta dogodek Sloveniji prinesel in pomemben premik na področju okoljske odgovornosti. Gospa Tavčar, izvolite.
Hvala lepa, spoštovana ministrica, cenjena ekscelenca, dragi gostje. Lepo pozdravljeni na mednarodni konferenci o okoljski odgovornosti v Sloveniji, ki jo gosti Ljubljana, zelena prestolnica Evrope leta 2016. Ponosna sem, da danes s to konferenco dajemo še večji poudarek odgovornosti glede okolja v Sloveniji. Ta dogodek podpira tudi Evropska unija. To je velik dosežek za našo državo, pa tudi za naše podjetje TaxFinLex, ki na trgu deluje že 14 let in mu je bila ta naloga v okviru projekta EcoLex Live zaupana. Prepričana sem, da se vsak od nas zaveda, kaj pomeni odgovornost glede okolja. Pa ne samo zaradi nas, ampak predvsem zaradi naših otrok. Verjamem, da si vsi želimo, da jim zapustimo čisto okolje in s tem lepo prihodnost. Iskreno veseli, ko vidim, kako otroci že sami pravijo, da je potrebno ločevati odpadke. To pomeni, da so že odgovorni do okolja. Lahko bi celo rekli, da je ozaveščenost do okolja med mladimi že tu. Zavedamo pa se, da so nekatere skupine, ki imajo tu še določen manko. Mineva namreč dobro leto dni od nekaterih odmevnih primerov povzročene okoljske škode v Sloveniji, no, pa tudi nekaj manjših se je vmes zgodilo in podjetja, Kar dve tretjini malih in srednjih podjetij je takih, ne poznajo niti zakonskih podlag glede odgovornosti za okoljsko škodo. Kako je torej z odgovornostjo za okoljsko škodo? Kako sanirati posledice, če se le ta zgodi? Kako je s tveganji? In kako predvsem vzpostaviti nazaj tisto stanje, ki je bilo pred samo nesrečo? O vsem tem bomo govorili danes. Slišali bomo stroko in prakso iz nekaterih evropskih držav, videli, kako je s tem v Sloveniji in se seznanili z dobrimi praksami naših sosednjih držav. Vse to pa bo kot neka popotnica še boljšemu uresničevanju Evropske direktive o okoljski odgovornosti v Sloveniji. In to je namen današnje konference. Hvala lepa.
Hvala lepa, gospa Tavžar, ki se je šele začela privajati na sodelovanje na odru na tej konferenci, glede na to, da ima zelo pomembno vlogo. Na odr pa zdaj vabim tudi častno govornico, gospo Ireno Majcen, ministrico za okolje in prostor v vladi Republike Slovenije. Izvolite.
Spoštovane udeleženke, udeleženci, spoštovani veleposlanik, direktorca, sodobne družbe, zlasti njihova ekonomska struktura, ne vsebujejo avtonomnih mehanizmov samoomejevanja, s katerim bi človeštvo na dolgi rok ohranjalo naravno ravnovesje in s tem naravno podlago lastnemu življenju. Zaradi zavedanja o pomenu ohranjanja narave oziroma okolja za dolgoročni obstoj človeštva, je mednarodna skupnost sprejela vrsto mednarodnih pogodb, ki naslavljajo globalne probleme ohranjanja narave, varstva okolja in upravljanja naravnih virov. Izjemno obsežna je na tem področju zakonodaja Evropske unije in držav članic, med njimi seveda tudi Republike Slovenije. V tem okviru ima poseben pomen prav direktiva o okoljski odgovornosti v zvezi s preprečevanjem in sanacijo okoljske škode, ki smo jo v slovenski pravni red prenesli z zakonom o varstvu okolja in na njegovi podlagi izdanimi izvršilnimi predpisi. S to direktivo je prvič vzpostavljen inštitut, ko imajo preko države, malce poetično rečeno, pravico za ugotavljanje okoljske škode, odgovornosti in za preprečevanje oziroma odpravo okoljske škode, tudi posamezni deli narave. V mislih imam zavarovane rastlinske in živalske vrste, vodo in tla. Klasično razumevanje škode je v civilnem pravu namreč omejeno na škodo, ki je povzročena zdravju ali premoženju posamezne osebe. In le ta lahko uveljavlja tudi odgovornost za povračilo storjene škode. Vendar vsa ta izjemna količina pravnih aktov ne ohranja narave ter okolja in ne učinkuje sama po sebi. Za njeno učinkovito izvajanje je izjemno pomembno poznavanje in ponotranjanje te zakonodaje, kakor tudi njeno spoštovanje in izvajanje. Ministrstvo za okolje in prostor se zaveda izjemnega pomena, ki ga ima za dosego tega cilja ozaveščenost vseh, ki so vključeni v izvajanje okoljske zakonodaje. Zaradi tega ministrstvo podpira prizadevanja, ki se nanašajo na širitev in poglobitev informiranosti in ozaveščenosti glede preprečevanja in sanacije okoljske škode. Evropska unija je razvila vrsto mehanizmov, tudi finančnih, ki prispevajo k dvigu ozaveščenosti glede pomena ohranjanja narave oziroma varstva okolja in rabe naravnih virov. Pomembno mesto med njimi vsekakor zavzemajo tudi projekti LIFE. Zaradi tega sem vesela, da je podjetje Tax Finlex s partnerji uspelo pridobiti LIFE projekt, katerega cilj je dvigniti ozaveščenost glede izvajanja direktive o okoljski odgovornosti v Sloveniji. Izvedbo tega projekta sofinancira tudi naše ministrstvo. Na srečo smo v Sloveniji do zdaj imeli samo eno okoljsko nesrečo, ki sodi v okvir tako imenovanih ELD primerov. Iz tega primera se je mogoče naučiti vsaj dvoje. Da je treba izboljšati sistem delovanja pristojnih organov in institucij ter vključevanja javnosti v primeru okoljskih nesreč. Prav tako pa sem prepričana, da je dvig informiranosti o okoljski zakonodaji in ozaveščenosti glede odgovornosti za preprečevanje in sanacijo okoljsko škode en najučinkovitejših ukrepov za zmanjševanje tovrstnih dogodkov. K dvigu ozaveščenosti bodo vsekakor prispevali tudi dejavnosti in rezultati tega projekta. Zaradi tega vam želim uspešno delo na konferenci in pri izvedbi projekta v celoti. Hvala.
Hvala lepa, gospa ministrica. Naslednji govornik je njegova ekscelenca, gospod Paolo Trikilo, veleposlanik Republike Italije v Sloveniji. Italija je kot naša soseda ena najnaprednejših držav na področju okoljske odgovornosti, seveda tudi zaradi številnih različnih izkušenj v tej veliki državi. Skratka, gospod veleposlanik nam bo predstavil italijanski vidik okoljske odgovornosti. Izvolite.
Hvala lepa. Spoštovana ministrica za okolje in prostor, direktorica, cenjeni gosti, dragi prijatelji, minister, director, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it is a big pleasure for me to be here today to this very important international conference. And this issue is very dear to my heart. One of my previous posts was that of deputy permanent representative at the OECD. And you know that it was there, the OECD in 1972, that the polluter pays principle was first adopted, and that has become the cornerstone of many international agreements and international and national policies in this area. And when I was there, the 40 years of this very important cornerstone was celebrated. So I would like to say that as far as Italy is concerned, and thank you very much for inviting a neighboring country. The implementation of the European Environmental Liability Directive by Italy, we should stress an important piece of legislation that was introduced in 2015, which has complemented the previous acts. The new law has brought some important changes, particularly by strengthening the polluter pays principle, so avoiding significant costs for public finances, as well as by implementing strict liability for environmental damage, reinforcing repair standards to restore damage in the natural resources, particularly for the biodiversity. I will skip the next part of my speech, as I have learned that Mr. Danilo Margaroli from the Italian Ministry of Finance will speak with much better expertise than me on the content of the Italian legislation, and he will be able to address this in details and reply to questions, if any. I would only say that I think Italy has made a very significant progress and achieved important results, even though in this very important issue of environmental liability, you always have to strive for the best implementation possible. I think that looking ahead, in order to avoid or at least limit to a significant degree the environmental threats, is important also to follow new approaches such as the green economy and the circular economy. And this theme is also linked to the Italian National Business Plan 4.0, that in fact many of the enabling technologies referred to in the plan respond to the needs of companies to reduce energy and or environmental impacts, or to make processes more efficient, for example, by reducing waste and reusing materials. And the green theme is also added value of innovative startups registered in the Italian special section of the business register, and 15% of which, out of about 8,000, are high-tech in the energy field. The green economy is indeed becoming a flagship of the Made in Italy and the pillar of our production system. Italy is a leader in Europe in green economy, and according to the Green Italy Report 2017, more than a quarter, 27.1%, of Italian manufacturers and service companies have invested in green technologies in the period 2011-2016. And green economy is also an important leverage for development in the small and medium enterprises that have invested in green technologies in the last 3 years. And they expect an increase in their turnover. I also would like to mention that Italy is also characterized by low levels of waste production and high level of recycling. As far as Italy and Slovenia are concerned, we have an excellent economic cooperation. Italy is Slovenia's second trade partner with 7.57 billion euros of bilateral trade in 2017. Italy is the fourth investor with over 1.1 billion euros at the end of 2016. In this framework, an important role is played by companies engaged in green economy. And one very recent example is the grant awarded from Bio-Based Industries joint undertaking to the consortium led by Aquafuels Law for the implementation of the program Effective, aimed at developing economically viable ways to produce sustainable fibers and plastic films. As shown also in the Circular Change Conference recently in Maribor this year, but also the previous year, there is indeed ample space for further cooperation between Italy and Slovenia, and of course also other European partners. So I think we are set on a very good path of cooperation, and we will of course strive to increase it further together. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Hvala lepa.
To je gospod veleposlanik. Na koncu pa vas bo v imenu mestne občine Ljubljana pozdravila še gospa Nataša Jazbinšek-Seršen, vodja oddelka za varstvo okolja. Ljubljana se želi uveljaviti kot eno izmed najrazvitejših, ne samo evropskih, pač pa tudi svetovnih mest na področju okolja. Kar pogumno.
Spoštovana ministrica, spoštovani ambasador, spoštovana direktorica in seveda dragi udeleženci te mednarodne konference, dober dan in lepo pozdravljeni v Ljubljani, zeleni prestolnici Evrope. Prisrčen pozdrav tudi v imenu župana najlepšega mesta na svetu, tako kot vedno znova poudari gospoda Jankovića, ki se žal danes zaradi drugih obveznosti tega dogodka ni mogel udeležiti. Ljubljana, zelena prestolnica Evrope v letu 2016, zagotovo naziv, na katerega smo zelo ponosni. Vendar pa naš cilj ni zgolj biti oziroma pridobiti ta prestižni naziv, ampak je naš cilj biti zelena prestolnica zavedno. In to seveda pomeni, da želimo, da je naš cilj dosegati visoke okoljske standarde. Tisto, kar na vseh področjih delovanja vedno znova poudarjamo, je dosegati visoko kakovost življenja za naše meščanke in meščane. In to seveda pomeni zdravo in čisto okolje. Te cilje smo si pravzaprav zastavili že mnogo let, preden smo prejeli ta prestižni naziv. In sicer v letu 2006, ko smo zasnovali in začeli živeti našo vizijo, vizijo do leta 2025, in takrat smo rekli, da bo Ljubljana idealno mesto, prijazno mesto, ki bo ohranjalo svojo zeleno identiteto, da bo sonaravno mesto in vse slovenska metropola z visoko kakovostjo življenja, strpno, varno in solidarno mesto, mesto po meri človeka. In v tem času, torej od sprejetja vizije do danes, smo izvedli preko 1900 različnih projektov, velikih, manjših projektov, in ko nam je pravzaprav Evropska komisija podelila naziv Zelena prestolnica Evrope, so podali sporočilo, in sicer Ljubljana je mesto, ki je naredilo največ sprememb v kakovosti življenja, v smeri trajnostnega razvoja, v smeri doseganja visokih okoljskih ciljev v najkrajšem možnem času. In to nam je zelo veliko pomenilo. Povedali so, bodite zgled drugim, predvsem tistim, ki na to pot šele vstopajo. Skratka, za nami je res dinamično obdobje, obdobje številnih izzivov, pa tudi obdobje, ko smo se zelo veliko učili, naučili, pridobili izkušnje, ki jih bomo zagotovo s pridom izkoristili tudi pri naših naslednjih ciljih. In prišli smo do enega ključnega spoznanja, da je za vse to izjemno pomembno sodelovanje. Najprej sodelovanje znotraj velike MOL-ove družine, ki šteje kar 12.000 zaposlenih v mestni upravi, v javnih zavodih, v javnih podjetjih. Potem seveda sodelovanje z vsemi ključnimi deležniki, kot so na primer nevladne organizacije, podjetja, državne institucije, in pa seveda sodelovanje z vsemi posamezniki, z našimi meščani in meščankami. Namreč prav vsakdo lahko prispeva k razvoju mesta. In seveda ni zgolj pravica vsakega posameznika, da živi v zdravem in čistem okolju, ampak tudi dolžnost, tudi odgovornost za svoje ravnanje. 1900 projektov seveda ni mogoče na kratko povzeti, našteti, lahko pa jih strnem v tiste vsebine, kjer so se v Ljubljani zgodile največje spremembe. Zagotovo na področju trajnostne mobilnosti, in če omenim trajnostno mobilnost, ne morem mimo ključnega projekta zaprtja mestnega središča za ves promet, ki je bistveno spremenil kakovost življenja v Ljubljani. Potem trajnostno ravnanje z odpadki. Mimo grede, Ljubljana je v samem evropskem vrhu po ločeno zbranih odpadkih, ta delež je danes kar 67-odstoten. Pijemo zdravo, čisto in predvsem naravno vodo, tisto vodo, ki jo načrpamo iz podzemne vode, je ni potrebno predhodno podvreči nobenim tehnološkim postopkom, kar pomeni, da je zares čista in ohranjena. Zelo veliko v zadnjih letih smo delali na prenovi degradiranih območij. Ljubljana ima že sama po sebi zelo impresivno zeleno identiteto, kar 3/4 celotne površine je zelene, pa vendar smo veliko naredili tudi na področju degradiranih območjih in tako se danes lahko pohvalimo s kar preko 100 hektarov novih urejenih zelenih površin. In seveda ne moram niti mimo zelo pomembnega področja, ki bo zelo pomemben predvsem v prihodnje, in sicer področje samooskrbe. Za vzpostavljanje novih vrtičkarskih območij predvsem poskušamo našim meščanom in meščankam omogočiti, da pridejo do svojega koščka zemlje, da lahko vrtnarijo, spodbujamo ekološko kmetovanje in ekološko vrtnarjenje in krajšamo verige oziroma poti od njive pa do mize. In ko smo že pri samooskrbi, je prav, da omenim tudi čebelarjenje. Čebelarjenje je v Sloveniji, ima bogato tradicijo, tudi v Ljubljani, in prav na pobudo Slovenije smo pred dnevi praznovali prvi svetovni dan čebele. Mi pa smo še posebej ponosni, ker je v razcvetu prav urbano čebelarjenje. In danes lahko pravzaprav znotraj širšega mestnega središča najdemo že skoraj 100 lokacij s čebeljimi panji, med pridobljen iz teh čebelnjakov pa izredne kakovosti, brez primesi pesticidov, insekticidov, brez primesi težkih kovin in drugih škodljivih snovi. Skratka, kar nekaj, kar je bilo postorjenega, čakata nas dva velika izziva, v katerega smo že zagrizli z velikimi koraki, in sicer prehod iz linearnega v krožno gospodarstvo, podnebne spremembe, skratka, izzivov ne manjka. Ključno za doseganje teh visokih okoljskih ciljev pa so predvsem jasna vizija, kam torej želimo priti, pogum, ki ga našemu županu vsekakor ne manjka, veliko znanja, ki smo ga v tem času pridobili, in pa sodelovanje, kar sem že pred tem omenila. In z roko v roki se zagotovo da premikati gore. Skratka, za zaključek želim vam uspešno konferenco, želim veliko dobrih idej, izmenjave dobrih izkušenj, predvsem pa prijetno bivanje v Ljubljani in tisti, ki ste prvič v našem mestu, upam, da bo kaj priložnosti tudi za raziskovanje našega mesta in da se boste k nam radi vrnili tudi ob drugih priložnostih. Hvala lepa.
Hvala lepa, gospa Jazbinšek Seršen. Zdaj pri visokih predstavnikih mesta in gospa Jazbinšek Seršen seveda je taka, ni vprašanje, ali bodo povedali, da je Ljubljana najlepše mesto na svetu, ampak kdaj bodo to povedali. Zdaj po hitrosti ste skoraj da že na ravni župana. In še eno pomembno obvestilo ob koncu naše konference, torej konferenca se bo zaključila potem na terasi hotela Intercontinental, tako da boste imeli enega izmed najboljših možnih pogledov na Ljubljano od zgore, ampak jo je seveda pa treba spoznavati tudi od spodaj. Tako, zdaj pa začenjamo z delovnim delom današnje konference. Izhodiščni strokovni prispevek bo dal dr. Hans Lopata, svetovalec Evropske komisije za pravne zadeve pri Evropski komisiji, dela na Generalnem direktoratu za okolje, gre pa za uglednega pravnega strokovnjaka, ki je že v svoji domovini Avstriji se ukvarjal s temi vprašanji, bil je na Avstrijskem okoljskem ministrstvu vodja pravno-zakonodajnega oddelka in prav on je pri Evropski komisiji v Generalnem direktoratu za okolje odgovoren za izvajanje direktive o okoljski odgovornosti. Naslov njegovega predavanja bi v bistvu lahko napisali kar v Sloveniji, okoljska odgovornost, odgovornost vseh ali nikogar, ampak zdaj bomo slišali seveda evropsko perspektivo tega vprašanja. Spoštovane gostje in gosti, dr. Hans Lopata. To so meine Ansage in Slovenisch. Bitte, willkommen. Danke. Und wir haben 15 Minuten. Auch die Slowenen sagen, in der Kürze liegt die Würze. Und das werden wir hier auch erleben. Vielen Dank.
Ja, distinguished Minister, distinguished Ambassadors and dear participants, good morning. And thank you to the organizers for having invited me, for having given the opportunity to the Commission to not only participate in this important event, listen to you, but also provide a short overview on the Environmental Liability Directive, I will take you through some slides on the background, on the main principles of the directive, on the past developments, and in particular on the more recent evaluation of the effectiveness of the directives with the main conclusions and recommendations drawn from this evaluation, and then what followed from it, where we are right now. We are right now in this multi-annual work program on better implementing the Environmental Liability Directive, and at last I will give you an outlook on what is planned in the near future and may address your questions. It was mentioned already by my predecessors, we are here in the frame on environmental protection. The minister mentioned preserving the nature, and the representative of the city of Ljubljana also mentioned the need to preserve human health and a good environmental status. And this is actually the background also of the Environmental Liability Directive. It was triggered by some major accidents with very big losses, and one of the most important was, sadly, but it was a fact, in 1998, this big accident which happened in Andalusia in Spain, called then afterwards Doñana accident, because the dam which broke there even entered rivers and affected negatively the biodiversity of a very important nature reserve. The costs amounted to more than 240 million euro, and the operator, Boliden, couldn't be held liable due to the fact that there was no appropriate liability legislation, neither at national nor at European level. And such a kind of accidents, they happen from time to time in Europe, but they are not the only reason for the Environmental Liability Directive, because there are a lot of many other significant damage events, emissions or incidents, and this was the reason which triggered the Environmental Liability Directive. The directive which focuses on damage to land, to damage to water, and damage to protected species and habitats. Okay. So it should not be, the rationale was that we cannot continue with leaving such damage to natural resources unremedied, but we need to restore these damaged natural resources. And the principle of doing this is the polluter pays principle. Not the general taxpayer, not the general public should pay for it, but those who actually have caused the damage. Therefore, in 2004, the directive has been adopted, establishing a legal framework for preventing and remedying environmental damage. These are the two major objectives of the directive, based on the polluter pays principle. Now, the liability under the directive is a strict liability channeled to some professional activities which are listed in the directive. The liable persons are the operators who are carrying out these activities, and they have to take the necessary preventive and remedial action and to bear the costs. But the operators are not the only major players under the directive, and this answers partly already the question of this section. There are also the competent authorities who play a major role, because they have the oversight. They have to enforce the directive, for example, by determining the significant damage, identifying the liable polluter, etc. And then there is also a role for civil society, for those persons who are actually affected by such environmental damage, and for certain recognized environmental NGOs. They may then ask the competent authorities to take an action and to take a decision as to whether the environment needs to be remedied according to the requirements of the directive. And there are, of course, other important stakeholders, like the financial security providers, and here in the field of unknown liabilities, uncertain liabilities, it is mainly the insurance sector, which plays an important role and or should play an important role. And this all should not only be a development at national level, but the starting point was to create a better level playing field at European level, to establish some minimum requirements within this framework directive as regards, for example, strict liability, the most important damage categories, land, water, biodiversity, or the participation of the civil society and NGOs in the implementation of the directive. It is very important to understand that this directive is not a civil liability directive, which provides for a monetary compensation to victims or to whatever organizations, but the main objective, or the objective of the directive, is just to restore the once damaged natural resources, land, water, biodiversity, to their baseline condition which existed before such a damage occurred. And therefore, it was decided that this could be best achieved not through a civil liability instrument, but through an administrative or public liability instrument, an environmental liability system, which is dealing only with this environmental damage and not with traditional damage, which is damage to property or personal injury or even in many cases economic loss. This traditional damage, normally addressed by civil liability instruments, is still remaining a national domain. It remains within the remits of the long-standing national civil liability law remits. Now, the directive is most important as regards the scope of or the strict liability standard, which means that only that the operator, that the competent authority doesn't need to provide a proof of fault on the part of the tortfeasor, on the part of the polluter. So it is not necessary to demonstrate that the one who has caused the damage acted on basis of negligence or even intent. It is sufficient that the causal link needs to be established. This is the basic necessity. This is required that there needs to be a link between the activity and the damage. But as regards the strict liability standard of the directive, which relates to those dangerous activities which are listed in an annex, Annex 3 of the directive, for this strict liability, it is not necessary to demonstrate fault. There is a fault-based liability standard as well in the directive, which is minor important. And while only these listed certain occupational activities are falling under the scope of strict liability, all other occupational professional activities, if they cause damage to protected species or damage to natural habitats, they are also relevant for fault-based liability under the directive. Yeah, this slide just provides you an overview on the functioning in a schematic presentation. So before the directive is triggered, operators who are falling into the scope of the strict liability, they should be aware in the first place. They should make some risk analysis, risk assessment. And if they conclude that they could be potentially affected as liable operators, then they should take precautionary measures, for example, by looking whether their financial cover is sufficient to cover such damages, or to take some risk management or environmental management schemes like EMAS, ISO 14001, whatsoever, or to look into mitigation or abatement technology so as to reduce their potential risks. But then if there is an imminent threat of damage, meaning that if there is a situation arising through due to the activity, that an environmental damage may occur in the near future, they have to take the preventive actions. If these preventive actions are not sufficient or if it is already too late, then they have to take the remedial actions afterwards. So these are the main objectives, and the liable operators also have to bear all the costs involved in it. Yeah, and the slide again shows the different functions of the other players like the NGOs and the competent authorities. And on the left down corner at the bottom, it shows you in nearly unreadable size the three main types of remediation: primary, complementary, and compensatory remediation. But this is already detailed. For now, we go on with the developments. The directive, which was adopted in 2004, had to be transposed until April 2007. And well, after some delay, it was finally transposed by all member states by the middle of 2010. By that time, the Commission issued a first report on the effectiveness of the environmental remediation under the directive and on the availability of financial security to operators who fall under strict liability. And then the Commission issued a second report with some delay only in April 2016, together with a so-called refit evaluation on the effectiveness of the directive, efficiencies of the directive, EU added value, and some other criteria. And there were some major conclusions drawn from the directive. So there were some positive developments. It showed that the directive in principle is working in many member states. But it showed also that it is some features like the remediation methodology is underused. Also some remediation, damage remediation categories are underused. And most and foremost, it showed that the directive is not only transposed, but also implemented in a quite divergent manner. So there is a high variance between the member states, which which shows that in two member states there are, or in 85 or 95 cases on the average per year occurring. In some member states there are between 10 and three annual cases. There are a few member states where it's only one case on the average in a year, or not even, and which is more worrying, 11 member states, they have not reported any environmental damage instance in this reporting period between 2007 and 2013. So this brings, I think, in a very illustrative way, shows the effect that the directive is not so well implemented, and the level playing field could be better. Now, what would be the main reasons for this high variance and also for the underuse of the directive, at least in several member states? The Commission report and refit evaluation has also covered these questions and tried to provide some answers, but we are still, developments are going on, and we are all the time still discussing this and finding new answers to these questions. But what we can see so far, it is clear that one of the factors is the continued use of pre-existing national legislation, which some member states clearly prefer to the environmental liability legislation. If this previous legislation is covering the main requirements, the main purposes of the directive, then it is fine. But in most of the cases, they have a different objectives, they have a different scope, and this may create a problem, in particular with regard to the EU level playing field. One of the reasons for this is also that different member states apply a different significance threshold. The directive is only applicable to significant environmental damage to water, to land, or to protected species and natural habitats. And there are quite differences between member states. Some member states, they don't regard this significant threshold at all, and others, they use it in a, I would say, or we in the Commission perceive this as a more reasonable manner. But there are also member states who believe that only the very biggest accidents are covered under the directive, which clearly is not the case, which is shown that by the fact that just for biodiversity damage, there are some determining criteria for the significance in an annex to the directive. And this clearly shows that not only the biggest damage occurrences or events should be covered. Then also the existence or non-existence of registers of such damage instances and ELD cases plays an intervening role. So those member states who have such registers are implementing better the directive. Also, there's a different extent to which member states involve or invite comments from the public in cases of environmental damage. Also, this acted on the implementation level, where competent authorities in member states act after a damage occurred and the operator did not act. Also there we have seen a better implementation. And most and foremost, it's the level of awareness of the ELD by all stakeholders, in particular of the operators, which plays an important role. Now, Lack of data, limited awareness, then some ambiguities and uncertainties around key concepts and definitions, insufficient financial security, and many exceptions and defenses. These are reasons for the limitations and weaknesses of the directive. Therefore, the RFID evaluation concluded that we need to support the implementation, and we need to support the competent authorities in the member states and all stakeholders by proactive information and capacity building, and such as awareness raising, stakeholder practitioner exchange, training seminars, etc., and to review the key concepts, key definitions, key terms, come to a better common understanding of what significant damage actually means, and other concepts under the directive. Oops, I think this is it. So, we found also that it would be necessary to establish an EU-wide register of ELD cases, or in the meantime, we speak of an environmental damage information system, and to agree on a set of indicators to measure the progress. Therefore, the Commission agreed together with the member states early in 2017 to establish an ELD multi-annual work program on better implementation of the directive. This was adopted in February 2017, and we worked together with the ELD government experts of all member states, and we have also an external technical consultant who supports us greatly. We also involve all stakeholder groups, meaning NGOs, financial security providers, and in particular also the operators, to they are all welcome and invited to provide comments and to discuss the progress within this ELD multi-annual work program. And the three main working areas are improving the evidence base, because we need to know better what is really going on. We need to understand better the high variance between the member states, and then we have a better basis to decide what needs to be done and where. We are working on such administrative support tools and guidance instruments. And the third most important area is financial security. Last year, we have developed, together with the help of our external contractor, a framework assessment, a set of indicators, and also an ELD information system, or let's say laid the basis for an ELD information system, which is composed of several parts, including a map viewer, a dashboard, and country fiches. And the work is going on this year, and we hope that we can complete it by 2019. Last year, we have also carried out an exploratory investigation on which supporting tools would be most useful, most needed, and it was found that we should continue with the ELD training program, which was set up several years ago, the face-to-face training, but also this should be supplemented by webinars. And it resulted from this investigation that an IT tool for risk assessment and better determination of damage should be looked into, whether this is possible to be developed at EU level. And we are also working with IMPEL. This is the network of the environmental authorities and inspectorates in Europe, on financial security since 2 years. And this year, the IMPEL project focuses on three most important tools on risk assessment and determining then the amount which is needed for damage remediation. These three tools or guidances are, one is from Spain, the other one from Ireland, third one is a new development in the Netherlands. And in addition to that, the Commission is launching also an in-depth investigation on the situation of financial security right now. This study should start by September this year, and the aim is to look into the situation on the ground in all 28 member states and also at EU level, and to identify main problems and also suggest some solutions, some conceptual solutions to these problems. So this is where we are right now, due to this multi-annual work program, which at least this one should end in 2020, and then we will see whether we will have a new multi-annual work program. The Commission concluded after the refit evaluation that it is not appropriate now to amend the directive while we have identified some weaknesses and shortcomings, but rather to now focus on the better implementation and practical measures and to exploit all the potential for improvement of the directive. And then it will be newly evaluated in 2020 or beyond, but this will then be a responsibility of the next commission, and then we will see further. And finally, I've also asked to address these two questions, which are not covered by the slides. What is recommended for countries to resolve at national level, which has not been solved by the directive? I would prefer not to provide here an answer, but maybe this could be also discussed in the panel. And then how to make maximum use of the polluter-pays principle when the polluter cannot be identified or when he went bankrupt. So unfortunately, I cannot give you a satisfactory answer to this question. It is said, but if the polluter is not able to remedy the damage, then the polluter-pays principle cannot be implemented, which does not say that the directive otherwise should be implemented with the requirements of remedying the natural resource damage. So any further questions are normally welcome, but I think we have no time now for it and may address them in the later panel discussion. Sorry for having run a little bit late, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lopata. There will be time for asking questions then after this first round of next speeches, which will.
Lep pozdrav spet v popoldanskem delu. Torej, moja naloga je, da vam na kratko predstavim, kaj sploh Ecolex portal oziroma projekt je. Nekaj besed v uvodu glede samega projekta. Kot smo že slišali, ne, ga podpira Evropska inicijativa LIFE, podlaga za to pa je seveda Evropska direktiva o okoljski odgovornosti, katere ključno sporočilo je preprečevanje in saniranje okoljske škode, če do nje pride, in ugotovili smo že tudi, da je plačnik te škode onesnaževalec. Zdaj nekaj številk o samem projektu. Partnerja projekta sta družba Taxfinex in pa komunikacijski partner Pristop Media. Trajanje projekta začel se je že pred dobre pol leta, kot vidite, sedaj smo na slabi sredini, zaključimo konec leta 2019. Proračun, ki ga imamo na voljo, da povečamo ozaveščanje glede okoljske odgovornosti v Sloveniji, pa znaša 1.300.000 evrov, pri čemer je sofinanciranje strani Evropske komisije inicijative LIFE skoraj 60%, 10% pa je dodalo tudi Ministrstvo za okolje Republike Slovenije. Kaj so bili razlogi, da smo sploh dobili ta projekt Ecolex LIFE? V prvi vrsti, kar sem že uvodoma omenila, nepoznavanje zakonodaje o okoljski odgovornosti. Drug razlog je seveda ta, ne, da je posledično zaradi nepoznavanja zakonodaje podjetja ne izvajajo preventivnih in tudi nesanacijskih ukrepov, tako kot bi jih morala, in vse to seveda vpliva jasno na povečana tveganja. Ne poznajo tudi, kaj sploh je vključeno v okoljsko škodo, ki, kot smo slišali že danes, je lahko povzročena tlem, vodi in biodiverziteti. Dejstvo je, da je tudi vsa zakonodaja na okoljskem področju izredno kompleksna, med seboj prepletena, marsikdaj pa tudi kontradiktorna. In še zadnje, ugotovljeno je bilo, da je med ključnimi deležniki slaba komunikacija in marsikdaj se tudi zaradi tega momenta zgodi, da se kakšne stvari dogajajo počasneje, kot bi si želeli. Predno smo dobili projekt EcoLexLife, smo naredili obsežno anketo. Rezultati so predstavljeni tu. 2/3 malih in srednjih podjetij ni seznanjena zakonodajo. To smo že slišali, ne? Tretjina njih je prepričanih celo, da jih zakonodaja niti ne zavezuje k preprečevanju in sanaciji okoljske škode. In na koncu, polovica malih in srednjih podjetij svoje odgovornosti nima zavarovane. Oziroma, če tole podrobneje pogledamo, tretjina med njimi pravi, da nimajo niti potrebe po zavarovanju, tretjina med njimi pravi, da se zanj še niso odločila in desetina med njimi pravi, da je to za njih prevelik strošek. To je bilo izhodišče in seveda, kako smo zdaj projekte kolek zastavili, kaj želimo z njim doseči. 5 stvari. Prvo, ozaveščanje. Tako je tudi naslov projekta in sicer vseh ključnih deležnikov, ki so na prvem mestu Ministrstvo za okolje in prostor, potem Agencija za okolje, gospodarska zbornica, nevladne organizacije in pa seveda zavarovalnice. Kako bomo dosegli njihovo sodelovanje in seveda tudi sodelovanje vseh vas preko delavnic, ki jih že uspešno izvajamo in pa danes je eden izmed takih dogodkov, torej mednarodna konferenca je tudi to. S tem, ko bomo ozaveščali ključne deležnike, bomo zmanjšali tveganja za nastanek okoljske škode. Tudi ta 4. točka je izjemno pomembna, povečanje krepitev administracije, mislim, da se tega vsi globoko zavedamo, vidi se že, da bo potrebno marsikaj postoriti na ministrstvu, tudi več ljudi za posamezna področja bo potrebno verjetno zaposliti, kajti to so zares kompleksne stvari, kot ugotavljamo sedaj na tretjini projekta in pa seveda prenos dobrih praks iz tujine. Kako bomo to dosegli z projektom EcoLexLife? Spet 5 točk. Najprej ozaveščanje, tako kot smo rekli, že z organizacijo delavnic in konference. Potem vzpostavitev online platforme, tudi to je že v teku, kaj boste tam lahko dobili. Novosti z področja okoljske, ne samo zakonodaje, ampak iz vseh področji, ki so seveda zelo kompleksna, ta seznam je že na razpolago, ga bomo kasneje videli. In pa predvsem na voljo vam bo ažurna okoljska zakonodaja in obrazložitve ključnih predpisov, da bodo vsi deležniki lahko lažje pravzaprav sploh delovali na tem zapletenem področju. Tretja stvar, vzpostavili bomo, mi smo temu rekli okoljski vodiči, ne, sicer v projektu se to imenuje Toolkits, bo pa to v pomoč vsem uporabnikom, da se bodo sploh lažje znašli glede na dejavnost, ki opravljajo in bodo s parimi kliki lahko dobili pravzaprav napotke, kaj morajo narediti za to, da bodo preprečevali, upam, da ne tudi sanirali okoljsko škodo, ki jo lahko povzročijo. Potem bomo izdelali vzorčne primere za oceno tveganja. Danes smo o tem že veliko slišali, verjamem, da bomo tu z pridom vključili tudi dobre prakse iz tujine. In seveda na koncu Evropska komisija od nas pričakuje tudi pripravo smernic za izvajanje zakonodaje na lažji način, bolj povezano v Sloveniji. Zdaj se pa nič ne dogaja. No, tule... Kot že omenjeno, tule je samo schematski prikaz vseh delavnic, ki jih izvajamo po Sloveniji. Naj vas ob tej priložnosti povabim, ker smo ravno tu v Ljubljani, 7. junija imamo naslednjo. Tu je tudi plan webinarjev in pa seveda mednarodna konferenca v letošnjem letu, v naslednjem letu bo še ena, tako da spremljajte nas. Izgradili smo tudi že portal. To je vstopna točka z vrsto informacij in novicami. Tamle gor je seveda navedena spletna stran. Ključni gradniki pa, kot sem prej pokazala, so tili štirje. In to zdaj počnemo, sedaj smo približno na polovici, in sicer eko-clipping, to so obveščanja, zakonodaja, zbirka vse veljavne zakonodaje, okoljski vodič in ocene tveganj. Če pogledamo vsakega po vrsti, kaj boste tam dobili? Eko-clipping imate, smo zelo ponosni na to, ker nam je že uspelo, v vaših vrečkah prvi vzorčni primerek. Si ga lahko ogledate, sicer pa lepo vabljeni na spletno stran, da ga dobite tudi tam. Tu dobite torej vse o spremembah okoljske zakonodaje, nove dodane vsebine, okoljske novice, novosti o live programu, ekomisli, skratka, vse v zvezi z okoljem. Če boste imeli kakršnokoli pobudo, dobrodošli, z veseljem vključimo zraven. Ključno je, da postane portal Ecolex Live osrednje mesto v Sloveniji, kar se vse v zvezi z okoljem tiče. Zakonodaja. To je bil velik izziv. Vzpostavili smo vso veljavno okoljsko zakonodajo, jo bomo seveda naprej tudi ažurirali, tako da boste lahko vsak trenutek dobili ta trenutek, tisti trenutek veljavno zakonodajo v obliki čistopisov. Povezana je na vse sodbe vseh slovenskih sodišč in seveda tudi dodana je EU zakonodaja, vključno z direktivami in uredbami, ki veljajo neposredno in jih je iz okoljskega področja kar veliko. Zraven pa boste prijeli tudi predpise v pripravi v Sloveniji, ne? Tako da boste resnično v celoti opolnomočeni, kar se tiče zakonodaje. Status tega dela je dejansko tako rekoč končan. Jaz sem napisala v zaključni fazi. Zakaj? Zato, ker bomo dodali še neki drobnari, ampak povabljeni ste, da se prijavite, na koncu boste točno videli kam. Tretji modul, ki ga moramo še izdelati in sedaj smo ravno kar začeli z njim, to bo za nas velik izziv, je okoljski vodič, kot sem rekla, smo ga poimenovali. Kaj boste dobili tu? Komentarje in razlage zakonodaje, povezane seveda z zakonodajo na tistem drugem modulu prej, potem seveda vprašanja, ne, in odgovore, ki jih boste sami zastavljali v zvezi seveda z direktivo o okoljski odgovornosti. Okoljske vodiče, ja, kaj bo zdaj to? Recimo, da smo, tle smo navedali en primer, da sem avtoprevoznik, ne, sodim v dejavnost, ki lahko povzroči okoljsko škodo, to pomeni prevažam neka goriva na primer, vtipkam v aplikacijo, da sem pač avtoprevoznik in potem mi aplikacija vrne vse predpise, ki jih moram upoštevati za to, kar počnem in me opozori seveda tudi na postopke, ki jih moram upoštevati, če bi prišlo do okoljske nesreče. To je zdaj še v pripravi, tega vam žal ne moram pokazati. Bo pa na naslednji mednarodni konferenci, zagotovo. No, in zadnji modul so te ocene tveganj, o katerih so kolegi, govorci iz evropskih različnih držav govorili, pa tudi naša kolegica. Skratka, tu bomo z veseljem povabili k sodelovanju predvsem zavarovalnice, ki nam bodo skupaj z vami pomagale opredeliti predvsem te dejavnike tveganja in na osnovi tega bodo nastali potem vzorčni primeri ocen tveganja za različne dejavnosti, ki jih izvajate. Naprimer, če sem zelo plastična, a ne, če imam jaz zdaj recimo, ne vem, neko dejavnost z nekimi kemično, naprimer, a ne v Ljubljani ali pa v Posočju in Posočje sodi, mislim, da v Naturo 2000, ne, je ocena tveganja, če to počnem, tam bistveno večja, kot če to počnemo v Ljubljani, ne? In podobno. Skratka, cel razvit mehanizem na voljo uporabnikom, predvsem malim in srednjim podjetjem, to moramo ob koncu tudi poudariti, ki nimajo na voljo ne sredstev, ne odvetnikov, ne služb, da bi jim lahko pri tem pomagale, mi pa od njih seveda pričakujemo, da so ozaveščeni in da razumejo zakaj pri okoljski odgovornosti gre. No, in s tem bi jaz seveda zaključila svojo prezentacijo. Takole tole zgleda ta trenutek na portalu Ecolex Live in lepo povabljeni, da se prijavite na teh dveh spletnih naslovih, ki sta tam, se registrirate in lahko boste že dostopali do teh informacij. Hvala lepa za vašo pozornost.
Najlepša hvala. Najlepša hvala, gospa Tavčar. Vas kar prosim, če ostanete na odru, kajti ne samo, da nam bo ta platforma pomagala pri vseh zavezah in seveda tudi interesih, ki jih imamo predvsem na področju večje odgovornosti do našega okolja in na vse zadnje seveda tudi povezano z drugimi odgovornostmi povezanih z okolji. Gre za to, da je današnji dan in ta konferenca namenjena tudi pobudi za povezovanje in sodelovanje na področju okoljske odgovornosti v Sloveniji. Nam lahko še nekaj več poveste o tem?
Ja, želeli bi izkoristiti to priložnost, ko smo se zbrali v tako velikem številu. Vi, predvsem domači poslušalci, da tako rečem, in akteri, in pa predavatelji, tuji govorci, da vas povabimo k recimo temu načelni podpori in pobudi k sodelovanju in povezovanju za to, da bo okoljska odgovornost v Sloveniji zares zaživela. V tem trenutku bi predlagala takole, da se zberemo na tem odru najprej, moram povedati najprej gospod Lopata, predstavnik Evropske komisije in seveda vsi ostali tuji in domači govorci in vsi tisti govorci, ki vas nastop še čaka. V drugem delu pa bi povabila zraven še vse vas, goste, udeležence konference. S tem, da bi bila to neka gesta podpore, kot sem rekla, sami boste lahko na spletni strani to pobudo, ki bo objavljena v takem preprostem tekstu, kot sem mu ga napovedal, še potrdili z vašim podpisom. S tem dejanjem tukaj pa zgolj samo, bi rekla, izkazujete to pripadnost temu gibanju, da Slovenija postane ozaveščena, kar se tiče okoljske odgovornosti.
Skratka, najlepša hvala vas. Vas zdaj seveda vse prosimo za podporo, vaša prisotnost na odru bi nam zelo veliko pomenila, bi pa kar prosil vse govorce današnjega dne, vključno tudi udeleženci okrogle mize, ki se bo začela malce kasneje, če se lahko za recimo temu prvi del fotografiranja pridružite na odru. So, now, we would kindly invite all the speakers of the today's conference, if of course you want to join us on stage to make a group photo to support this initiative. So I would kindly invite Mr. Lopata, Mr. Bitterman, Mr. Philip, Mr. Margaroli, Mr. Motherway, Mr. Ross, Mr. Busenhardt, and then the ladies, Ms. Grabnar, Ms. Hoiker, Ms. Šivković-Vrbica, Mr. Kosmač, Mr. Kočar, and Mr. Skubic, as well as participants of the panel, which will take place a little bit later on, including Ms. Huber-Heim, Ms. Berosh, and Mr. Gantar, to join us for the first group photo. And you know that all photos look better if the audience applauses, because then we have smiles. Skratka, najlepša hvala. Zdaj pa bi prosil še, kot je rekla gospa Tavčar, vse udeležence, če se lahko pridružite na odru za recimo temu, kot temu pravimo v Sloveniji, gasilsko sliko, brez gasilcev seveda, za podporo inicijativi. Now we would like to invite all participants for the group photo to support this initiative. It will be a little bit crowded, but no problem, we can manage it. It's Slovenia, which is not too big, so yeah. Now we don't know who will actually applaud, but yeah, the hostesses, torej hostese bodo poskrbele za aplauz. Se je kar dosti prostora. Kar vsi fotografi so dobro pripravljeni. Josephine, you too. And of course, don't forget, when being photographed, you should smile. Not too much, not to show your teeth or the missing teeth, but everything. Okay, and open your eyes, of course. Okay. Someone has to be on the lower level. Okay. Thank you very much. So the photos will be a success. Definitely you will see them also on the website. Jasno, da bomo fotografijo seveda objavili tudi na spletni strani konference, tako da boste videli, da ni šlo za kakšen fake photoshooting ali kaj podobnega. Današnjo konferenco bi radi pa zaključili z pogovorom, v katerem seveda vas vabimo tudi k sodelovanju na temo, kaj pa lahko v regiji, se pravi Slovenija, skupaj sosedi, storimo za boljše povezovanje na tem področju. Zato z veseljem vabim na oder in v omizje predstavnike petih držav, vključno Slovenijo, se pravi Slovenija in njene štiri sosede. Now, we would like to conclude this conference with a round table or, let's say, panel discussion about what our regions, so Slovenia and our neighbors, can do to improve collaboration and to do some more in this field we discussed today. So I'm really glad to invite the following ladies and gentlemen to the podium. Ladies first, Ms. Daniela Beroš, Senior Expert Advisor at the Ministry of Environment and Energy from Croatia. An applause would be nice. Ms. Karin Huber-Heim, the Academic Program Director of Sustainability and Responsible Management at the University of Applied Sciences, Vienna, Austria. Then Mr. Margaroli, Director General, Ministry of Environment, Land and Sea from Italy. Of course, Dr. Sandor Filip, President of the Environmental Management and Law Association from Hungary. And last but not least, Professor Dr. Pavel Gantar, a Professor of Sociology of Space and Environmental Sociology in Retirement, and also the former Minister of Environment, and also my ex-professor at the Faculty of Social Sciences, which is a very, very long time ago. But I'm very happy that today I will ask questions. But no grades, of course.
No grades.
Yes. But we should start with the ladies, which is of course also the Slovenian fashion. Ms. Beroš, well, you heard a lot of information today. Now we would like to add something more about what I think the Croatians need. Only one mic. Is it okay? What could we do better together? Because we are also a region, we are very closely connected. We used to be one country before, Slovenia and Croatia. We share some projects still, like the, let's say, nuclear plant in Krško, but of course also environmental issues. So where do you see the possibilities of doing together more for the benefit of our population, and also for the benefit of all Europeans?
Of course, we can always have some mutual agreements for rivers that are joint or something like that. I think on EU side we have to have some common criteria for serious damage or something like that, so we can have the same damages. If we say that something is damaged, that you say also that that is damaged. So I think that is the most important thing for this.
Same standards in way, but where do you see Croatia in the processes we discussed today? Because we had some examples from Italy, from Hungary, partly Austria, because of Mr. Lopata, who is also from Austria. How is the situation in Croatia, I mean, from this legal point of view?
So we have ELD from 2008, but we had EU pilot. So new legislation is from 2018. We had some new changes. We don't have any cases still, but we try to get better in it. Mm-hmm. We try to find some criteria which will be for everyone in Croatia to have a better communication between inspectors and other public authorities that are involved in ELD. And now we have better information to public and so on.
Ms. Huberheim, when we go to Austria, well, Austria stands out in a way just like Italy. Austria is also sometimes a role model, also when it comes to environmental issues. In Slovenia, we would like to be as Austria, sometimes not, of course. You don't have any access to open sea, so this is the big difference. Okay, when we take a look on the region, where do you see possibilities to do better together?
Well, definitely in the Alpi Adria region. I think the north of Italy, Slovenia, even Croatia, including and Austria, Hungary, all those. I have to say that all the former Austrian countries, they have such a great collaborative basis, actually. They should really thrive on that, and they should really, really take advantage of this, because what collaboration, and I could hear this all along in regard to cross-border activities or cross-border damages, this really needs trust. On a very large scale, in not only data and not only information or indicators, it also needs a lot of willingness to really work together and solve that, because environmental damages does not stop at borders. So this is really important that we have a common and mutual agreement and a common sense in really tackling this together. There are no borders in environment.
Regarding history, Mr. Philip does not agree.
So I mean, sorry to mention that.
But prior to 1866, where that were all, let's say, Austria, but then it changed Austria-Hungarian. But let us take a look in the future. But one more question: you come from academia. Is there a lot of exchange of knowledge, of know-how between academia from these countries?
Yes, I think so. I mean, at least in my, I can at least say this for my program in sustainability, we have 25 lecturers, and 15 of them are from Germany, Switzerland, Ireland, Hungary, Slovenia. So we really try to work with cross-border and or without borders.
Mm-hmm. But how could you improve this, let's say, exchange of knowledge, exchange of information, although it's apparently already there?
Well, it can always be improved. One of the issues that we have is the language. So in transferring the programs and the scientific exchange into English making it a common language, that would make things much easier. Because for me as a researcher or a scientist to publish in German actually does not make much sense for me, because it only has a small range, actually. So
small range of around 90 million.
Well, it's not, yeah, so but still the range in English is much, it's okay, much bigger.
True.
Spanish would be even better, but I'm not able to do that.
Okay.
Chinese would be much better.
Well, let's say first English, then Chinese.
Small steps.
Yeah, Dr. Philip, your take on how we should improve our regional cooperation.
Well, I see huge capacities in it. As we talked in the previous round, we talked about information. And we have an old saying, probably it's translatable, no one can be a prophet in his or her own home. But we mutually can have access, a better access to environmental information. So if you need a Slovenian information, you come to me and I ask your government and you can have an easier access and vice versa. So it's just half a joke. So I think an information pool is really promising. Another stuff that, as you just hinted, there are in my system a third or probably fourth category of investments like NUC, which deserves an eye on it from the neighbors. So the Paks nuclear power plant extension, I would be happier to have more support from, I mean, from, I'm speaking of the Hungarian, in the name of the Hungarian environmentalists. So would be much better, you know, if I were you, you know, I loudly protested, because that's in your backyard. So it doesn't matter that it's in Hungary, but if there is any problem, that's Austria, Romania, Slovenia, everywhere. Depends on the actual wind direction, which is turning. So that's for now.
Thank you. When we go to the Italian point of view, Italy is an old country, almost as old as Austria, if I may joke a little bit. But you presented well your system, which is apparently functioning. We heard the ambassador in the morning. How are you satisfied with the cooperation with your neighbors, and where do you think our region could be actually of benefit also for issues regarding Italy?
I personally think that cross-border cooperation would be very important, and in particular sharing information about environmental issues could be very useful. This is prescribed as well by the ELD directive. And I also agree with the fact that sharing technical guidelines will be very useful, so that every country, neighboring country, would have common ground to share information.
Okay, so sharing is caring also in this particular issue. Now I turn to my ex-professor, Professor Ganter. Well, could you tell us something about your position on, let's say, regional cooperation?
Well, thank you very much for the question. I will speak, I don't know very true, I speak Slovenian or English. I decided to speak English because...
You should speak English with a Slovenian accent.
That's what I wanted to say.
Which is extremely popular
my accent is actually horrible, yeah, and our Irish colleague will be certainly hurt by it, and so will you. So anyway, but nobody forced you to be here. So anyway, okay. Then, well... At the institutional level, there are many ways of cooperation among the countries in this region. There are different committees, commissions, stretching from the water issues to the environmental issues, nature protection issues. There is no there is a lot of different contacts at different levels and so on. So here, I don't see. I would like to see that this context, this. Decisions would be more efficient, maybe sometimes more proper, and so on. But this is the issue of our day-to-day discussion and assessment, and so on. What I would like to really to point out is that the NGO cooperation in this region is maybe even stronger in some aspects, some as a state and authorities cooperation. I should mention here, of course, the initiative in Istria. concerning Croatian NGOs, Slovenian NGOs, also Italian, concerning the some installations in Trieste. There is a strong movement, Austrian, Hungarian, Slovenian, and Croatian concerning protection of the river Mura, and there are many, many other initiatives. So what is important that I would like to say is not only institutional cooperation, but cooperation at the level of the civil society in initiatives, movements, and here I am very confident that this will go on. Even sometimes the authorities in all these countries will not be happy with all these activities, which is of course normal and of course also true.
Yeah, but no one can be super happy all the time, so it's a quite a normal situation.
Well, I found my two or three that they are happy all the time.
Okay, good for them. Well, my last question for the round before we turn also to the audience would be, because we were speaking about ELD, we're speaking about European Union, and we are all part of the European Union, which is a very good start. What could we do together to what Mr. Lopata said in the beginning, that we should actually do something more to strengthen awareness and, of course, to make the ELD even better? Do you see any possible cooperation in that? Yeah, you start because you have the mic.
I grabbed the mic, I know. Yeah. Not on the cooperational level yet, but please let me say something. I would really think that it would take us many steps further if, as proud as we are as nations, as to be Slovenians, to be Austrians, to be Germans, Swiss, or Hungarians, it would be wonderful that regarding environmental issues, we would start to feel like Europeans, because environmental issues do not stop at borders, and we, being Europeans, we have the chance mm-hmm. to solve these issues together and to tackle issues together, having this in our minds would be the first step, I think, how we could address these issues and how we could address building collaboration and building cooperation and sharing knowledge, sharing information. Mm-hmm. And certainly with this mindset, I think information and communication technologies provide us with great opportunities to share knowledge and to share best practices. Mm-hmm. Whereas I have to say I'm a big, I greatly favor personal contact and and personal relationships over media or electronic relationships, digital relationships. That I think is very important, because this builds trust. If I see someone, if I talk to my colleagues, if I can share experiences with the people who are concerned, with the people who are affected, not only with agencies and governments and industries, but also with the people, with the citizens, as you mentioned, that I think is really important to listen to them and reflect on their concerns. Mm-hmm. This is what stakeholder engagement actually should be about.
So we should also communicate more, we should travel more, but in a sustainable way.
Communicate, not talk, listen. Yeah. Really listen to concerns and reflect on it.
Well, listening is the difficult part always. Mr. Margaroli, what do you think about, let's say, possible initiatives within the region, so in and around Slovenia, to be addressed for the European Union to make our whole system even more efficient, better?
I would think, as it has been said before, that the concept of significance thresholds should be better clarified and defined, mm-hmm. and drafting technical guidance, preferably at EU level, could be helpful in this way. And this also in order to standardize the application of DLD, making it uniform in all member states.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now we go to Ms. Beros. What do you think about, let's say, a joint or coordinated attempt to make ELD even better, and also try, because we're Croatia and Slovenia on the verge of another region of high importance of countries which will probably join the European Union to lead by example. What initiatives do you see in order to improve this, also in other neighboring regions?
Of course, something like this, these conferences are very good when we can share our knowledges, informations, best practices. I think that, and the rest that my colleague said, that's all good for improvement of our cooperation. Mm-hmm.
Professor Ganter, before we give the microphone to Mr. Philip, well, how do you see this, let's say, possible cooperation on EU level from the region?
Well,
because you used to be a politician.
Yeah, well,
so
but
you
this is a long time ago. I'm happy about that that I passed this period anyway.
Some voters are also happy. So,
I indeed they are because I was not elected some 8 years ago. So, nothing to blame about it. But well, about the cooperation, I think it's very important that the institutions that are able to cooperate are properly staffed, professional, and that they are able to follow this intensive tempo. And Slovenia has all the time has a problem of understaffed institutions, particularly in the environment, and this is a real problem in many cases also regarding the environmental, not so much policy, but implementation. This is really a problem. But if you allow me, I would maybe add a few words about the awareness issue. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know whether or not you will agree with me, but Slovenia, there's a specific feature of Slovenian civic and political and public culture, and that is that if a problem appears, then Slovenians are somehow naturally inclined someone else to blame for it. And that's this mentality that the other are to blame for the problems we have is, of course, is not very fertile ground for rising environmental responsibility. But of course, it arises environmental awareness in the terms that the others are actually to blame for the environmental problems and issues. And I think we should change this in terms that we should actually increase the in Slovenia. There is no problem with environmental awareness, but it's a problem of with environmental responsibility. The issue here is responsibility also of the people who should ask themselves what they have done for the better environment. So I would like to say this in to this issue.
Yeah, it's not typically Slovenian, and we know who to blame because we always find yes
someone else.
No, it's the Austrians because we used to
yeah,
be
of course.
800 years under the Austrian rule. So this is something what we actually learned.
I wouldn't be Slovenian if I wouldn't agree with you.
Okay. So we should also present our practices to the outside.
This doesn't solve anything either, because the Austrian way of addressing and tackling problems is to sit them out and wait for something to happen. So this is not leading us anywhere. So I guess we all would need a slight change of operations here.
Okay, agreed completely. Dr. Philip, because in your presentation you also presented some goals or some adjustments to the present situation. Could you upgrade a little bit what you said in the morning regarding, let's say, harmonizing approaches and also these different, let's say, legal layers, administrative law, civil law, and environmental law?
Well, we really need a new age, the information age of networking, where system thinking is more spread out, but this is mentally, I think, tiresome. It's much easier to focus on one narrow field, and I feel like an expert, which is self-deception. And then it joins to the previous speakers that these social level defense mechanisms are not only shifting but denying. And the bigger the problem, the stronger is the defense mechanism, you know. So Canadians say global warming, that's a problem for others. You know, for us that's an opportunity, and let's go to the North Pole and drill some more crude oil. But I wanted to add another issue, because nation states seem to be more and more incompetent in a line of issues, and ELD is a very good example. So the ELD story started in early 90s, and a lot of toss and toil, and they circular procedures, they did not proceed, and that's why previous speakers mentioned scientific community cooperation, NGO networking, which might be much more effective. And I just would like to add the cities and another newcomer who is going to be to introduce a lot of fresh insights into that field.
And not only cities, we have actually a quite interesting initiative set up by Slovenian Hungarian member of the European Parliament, smart villages, so smart rural communities. Yes, yes, which could actually bring benefits to development in all fields, also for the societies and for the communities, which are, for example, endangered by emigration and other issues. So now we would like to open also the possibility for you to ask questions, because we have a very interesting panel here. Zdaj imate pa seveda tudi možnost da poveste vaše mnenje, glede na to, da so tukaj izjemno ugledni predstavniki različnih držav. Kakšno vprašanje, kakšno mnenje na temo, s katero se ja.
Katarina Draksler, občina Vrhnika. Jaz bi imela samo en komentar na to, da je premal zaposlenih na ministrstvu za okolje in prostor pa na okoljskem področju. Jaz v svoji magisterski nalogi nisem tega ugotovila. Ugotovila sem, da je problem predvsem v učinkovitosti inšpekcijskih organov in v preobsežni zakonodaji na področju prostora, na področju okolja. Glede na to, da ima sam zakon o varstvu okolja več kot 450 podzakonskih aktov, je to verjetno zelo težko nadzirati. In tako da to je v bistvu, to je, mislim, da glavni problem Slovenije na okoljskem področju, da bi mogla najprej zakonodajo tako urediti, da bi bila pregledna, potem pa, ker sem v bistvu tudi primerjala z Avstrijo pa z Italijo, ki imajo veliko boljši sistem tudi nadzora, in je tako, da to je bil moj komentar. Hvala.
Ok, hvala lepa. Skratka, vprašanje učinkovitosti, kakšen komentar mogoče? Any comment? Yes, of course, profesor.
Moj komentar je samo to, da bom z veseljem prebral vašo nalogo in pred vami tu prisežen, da bom spremenil svoje mnenje, če me boste prepričali o tem.
Dobro. Vsej kakšen študent vas je pa kdaj tudi že prepričal, ne?
Can I make a comment on this
yeah,
too?
Yeah, of course.
I think it would be very valuable to have communication and information as you provided it on the web portal now, or as you're providing it with the KISS method, meaning keep it short and simple, because I think especially SMEs are overwhelmed by such legislative commentaries and tons of paperwork that they have to do. They cannot afford like large corporations, legal departments that take care of that, and it's really it puts a big pressure on them to get this information and to process the information. So I think a portal with your kind of information that you're keeping setting up now is very valuable for especially SMEs.
Okay, thank you very much. Saj temu je seveda namenjen tudi ta portal, o katerem govorimo, ki bo seveda iz vsega tega pragozda predpisal seveda omogočil tudi, da vidimo kakšna drevesa. Tukaj imamo naslednje mnenje, izvolite.
Lepo pozdravljeni, profesor Cvetka Hedžetot, Filozofska fakulteta, Univerza v Ljubljani. Dovolite, da v kontekstu današnjega razmišljanja o varstvu okolja spregovorim nekaj o etiki. V preteklosti je bila etika bolj omejena na medčloveškost, razumevali smo jo kot sistem medčloveških odnosov. Okolje, narava, pa sta morala to definicijo etike korigirati. Preprosto zato, ker se je že v 19. stoletju pokazalo, da so meje ekonomske rasti pogojene z naravnimi danostmi. In v 19. stoletju imamo kar nekaj mislecev, ki so takratnemu napredku postavljali vprašanje, ja kak napredek je pa to, če ni etično utemeljen. Narava je pri Grkih bila druga plat etike in poglejte, za kulture, kot je starogrška in njihov panteizem je značilno, da je vsako življenje v naravi enako vredno. Človek ni več vredno bitje. Mi še danes vidimo, da te kulture, ki negujejo panteizem, upodabljajo kot eno enoto človeka in žival. Človek slon Indija, pri Grkih so bili to kentauri, človek konj, Egipt, svinga. Veste, to je čas, ko etika pomeni človekovo drugo naravo in na srečo ne proti narave. Vidite, to je pa krucijalni problem monoteizma, ki je s teorijo stvarjenja naravo človeku podredil in nenadoma etika postaja človekova proti narava, je onenaravljena in ravno sodobna okoljska etika opozarja, da moramo iz tega ven. Poglejte, danes govorimo o etiki biti in tu bi rada opozorila na ime Alberta Schweitzerja, ki je šel v Afriko študirati, a maja ljudje, ki živijo povsem elementarno življenje, o primarni življenjski skupnosti isto dojemanje za to, kar je prav, kar je pravično, kar ni pravično in ugotovil je, da so te strukture univerzalne. Tako poglejte, današnjo etiko biti, ki neguje najširšo odgovornost za vso svetovno bit in življenje v njej, zelo skušamo podkrepiti z načelom zlatega pravila in vidite, en tak orientir bi bil potreben v našem izobraževanju, ki bi že majhne otroke ozavestil, da gre pri etiki za držo tisto notranje. Ko jaz vse svetu berem s pomočjo notranjosti in svet je kot odprta knjiga sveta. Vsako življenje je sveto, je enako vredno, kot rečeno, etika biti in ne samo medčloveškosti. Dovolite pa, da za konec sporočim še tole, kar sem pripravila za danes. Povsem drugačna etika je etika tistih narodov, ki živijo globoko tesno povezano z naravo, povsem drugačna je pa etika tistih narodov, ki so prekupčevalsko usmerjeni. Etika slovenskega naroda je globoko povezana z zemljo, naravo in njenimi dogajanji. In tu bi rada vprašala tole. Ja, kakšni nasledki pa izhajajo za etiko mojega mehnega naroda, čemu je Evropa namenila prekupčevalsko usodo, kar je štacunarska bodalost. Tu seveda nam ne more biti vse eno in mnogi današnji prispevki, kakor jaz razumem, so vendarle izhajali iz te elementarne etične ozaveščenosti za vso svetovno bit, za življenje v njej in tudi tu je vsem nam mesto. Hvala lepa.
Najlepša hvala, gospa profesorica, za ta prispevek. Morda kakšen komentar omizja? Any comment perhaps from the panel? No? Yeah. Dr. Filip?
Thank you for the lecture. This is all that I can say as a business ethics teacher. Thank you very much. And I think it's very clear since the 90s, since the Rio conference, the UN Rio conference, that we have to think about future generations and also take their future into regard. And I think since then it is becoming a common knowledge that nature is not a resource, but it is the source of life on this planet. So, and under this under this perspective, I think all of this has changed since then, or is about to change. But of course, it takes time.
Okay, Dr. Philip,
I just wanted to add another aspect of this ethical approach. The intergenerational one, and historically, it's our age is quite unique, not giving honor to the parents, and we don't care the offspring, and then it's quite unique. In earlier ages, you know, just to mention the five American nations, the Iroquois big book, allegedly it influenced very much the later American political thinking. And if I asked my grandmother, for instance, or grandfather, did you buy something on installment payment or took loans? And they would not even understand it. Spend something which is not mine, impossible. So our age is quite unique from this angle, and we just do hope that it's transitional.
Dobro, hvala lepa. Še mogoče kakšno mnenje? Kakšen komentar? Zdaj, če ne, najlepša hvala. Najlepša hvala seveda tudi udeležencem tega posveta. Zdaj, mogoče samo še ena pripomba, ki je gospa profesor je omenila prekupčevalsko vlogo. Zdaj, če smo zelo pošteni, Martin Krpan je bil neke vrste prekupčevalsko, da pač tukaj nekaj zgodovine tudi imamo. Just to tell you, you know, there is a story is a big hero of Slovenian literature, was a 18th century smuggler. So I mean, so we have some history in that, but of course history timeline can change, so we have some history in that, but we can also change it. Če ni več nobenega prispevka iz občinstva, mogoče samo še eno vprašanje za vse udeležence tega panela. Za konec, kaj bi vi razumeli recimo kot nek bistven napredek, ki ga lahko storimo, če bi se zdaj recimo čez eno leto spet videli tukaj? Just to start for the last round of questions, and we start with you, Dr. Philip. If we meet here again in one year time, what would you consider as a step forward, what we would do in this 1 year on this field? What do you think is achievable? Where do you think we should actually tackle to make significant progress within 1 year? Because, you know, short-term people like the politicians, they're, okay, they're thinking about the next 5 minutes, perhaps, but we can at least think 1 year in a hat.
Shall I start? Maybe the greatest achievement would be that we wouldn't have feel the need to meet at all. So basically, that we wouldn't need to discuss any new environmental damage, environmental pollution case, and trying to see how the ELD directive has been applied and so on. So that would be my wish. But only a sentence. Today, with ELD directive, ELD and polluter pays principle. Polluter pays principle has existed way before the ELD, and of course it will exist, I believe, even when ELD will be changed or in this or another way. So I wanted to say, the question of treasure that has been posed is relatively high in most countries, but this, and it's very important. It goes by saying, but certainly the polluter pays principle is valid also for all the cases that does not fit the ELD, all small pollutions and so on and so on. So we should be aware of that. Polluter pays principle is involved in environmental legislation at large in Slovenia and applies also for small pollutions and should be so in the future as well. It can, ELD cannot be some sort of excuse that the small pollutions are not treated in a way in the polluter pays principle. That's what I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I would have two suggestions. The first one would be to make the 20 top SMEs or top companies in Slovenia aware of this and promoting this and have them to showcase and being them and show them as ambassadors to a different kind of behavior, to a transformational behavior, to more awareness, and have them as ambassadors for the issue. And the second thing I would really love to see, not only in Slovenia but also in Austria, I would love to see the top political proponents of the government to address this issue positively, not in a risky or just, you know, this is a new legislation, but addressing that this is important for our common future. And drop this line occasionally to the media, to everyone that where they have a public appearance, because I think this could also bring the whole issue on a very low cost to the minds of everyone.
Okay, we will have general election on June 3rd, so it's not quite a big topic right now, but perhaps afterwards. Afterwards, yes.
Well, 1 year time is short. Period of time, but I think that at your level we'll probably start talking about a European fund for the remediation of environmental damage. I think would be a good idea, especially for covering the cases of major accident, maybe cross-border environmental incidents, and in those cases where responsible has not been identified or is insolvent and financial guarantees didn't work.
Okay, thank you very much. Now one year plan from the Croatian point of view.
Okay, I can get to. In 1 year, I'm not so sure what can be done, but maybe some guidelines. More awareness, more. We are also understaffed, so more people that knows what is ELD. A lot of connections with these people that can maybe give us some new view to ELD, some new something that we didn't know before. And for professor's comment, I would like to say that the small, that the ones that are not ELD, they pay. They pay. The big ones are the problem, because they don't have enough money to pay for the big damage, for example, major accidents or something like that. So it is important maybe to have some common fund or something like that, which would be in EU or.
Okay. Which gives us, of course, a good line to Dr. Philip for his final words, because you mentioned the big guys and the bad guys and the bad girls. We added, which is of course very important to get them. And this would definitely be makeable. Thank you very much for your contribution to this conference. And of course, have a nice remaining of the day, especially up there at the roof of the hotel. We'll shortly get there. So thank you very much. But before we give the last word to Ms. Taucher, I will just go there to our graphic wall, because it's almost completed. And of course, it was not a part of the plan, but the young lady there, Josephine, was drawing it for the whole day. So she may be perhaps able to tell not only drawing and writing, but also to say us something. Why do you choose these colors? How did you make this wall, and what do you personally find it the most important issues here?
First of all, I have to say thank you for having me here. It was really an interesting conference for me, and I'm glad to hear it so much more about this topic. What stuck to my mind was one wonderful sentence in the last part of this conference, and it was like, let's start to feel like a bit more like Europeans. And I think this is a wonderful phrase which is gathering all of this together, and especially also having this point of focus, which I heard in all of these presentations, is the future perspective and this platform. So maybe I just give it back to you. Thank you so much. And just have a look here. You can find maybe some details, and maybe it can help you to remind a bit more of this conference. This is actually the goal of a graphic recording. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Big applause to Josephine. Of course, you can also take photos of the graphic wall free of charge to remember everything which is there. We see a part of this graphic wall also on our big screens, but of course, you're free to take photos and to have all memories memorized, and you can take them then home. And it is the best of Slovenian best practices. The ladies have the last word, so I kindly invite Ms. Taucher again to give us, let's say, some more focused guidelines for the remaining of the day, and of course for our work in the future. Zdaj pa še zadnja beseda, torej povzetki dneva strani gospe Zlate Taučar. Izvolite.
Hvala lepa. Zanimivo, spet smo končali pri petih zaključkih, ne? Vse okrog številke pet pri meni danes. Na prvo mesto pri današnjih zaključkih mednarodne konference bi postavila sodelovanje. Veliko je bilo govora danes o tem in mislim, da ne samo vseh teh pet deležnikov, ki ste jih videli lahko v moji prezentaciji, to se pravi tu v Sloveniji, ne, ministrstva, agencije, nevladnih organizacij, zavarovalnic in predvsem podjetij, ampak tudi sicer sodelovanje vseh držav v Evropi in tudi vseh pravzaprav uporabnikov. Le na ta način bomo prišli do tistega pravega rezultata. Drug zaključek bi rekla, da je seveda ozaveščanje. To, kar je bil pravzaprav predmet današnje konference in sicer dosegamo ga lahko s takšnimi delavnicami, konferencami, cilj njegov pa je predvsem preprečevanje, pravzaprav priložnosti, možnosti za nastanek okoljske škode. Tretji cilj bi postavila, oziroma zaključek, no, bi postavila sanacija, če se že zgodi, ne, da so jasni tu ukrepi, postopki, da so vnaprej opredeljena tudi tveganja in sicer vse s ciljem, da se pride do čim prej, čim bolj uspešno do referenčnega stanja, se pravi do stanja, ki je bilo pred samo okoljsko škodo, ki se je zgodila. Seveda ne na zadnje, oziroma pred zadnje na četrto mesto bi postavila zakonodajo. Zakonodaja, ki mora biti jasna, enostavna, transparentna, ne v nasprotju sama s seboj, predvsem s ciljem bi rekla, da dosega pravzaprav hitre ukrepe, jasne postopke, če prihaja pravzaprav do škode, oziroma predvsem, da je vsem akterjem zelo jasno, kaj je potrebno početi. In ne nazadnje, petič, dobre prakse. Dobre prakse, predstavljanje njih, govoriti o njih, tako evropske kot slovenske, in lahko obljubim, da bomo na naslednji konferenci, tako kot je rekla gospa Karin, predstavili, ne vem, če 20, ampak zagotovo uspešne SME-je v Sloveniji, ki bodo pokazali na svojih lastnih primerih, kako se zavedajo okoljske odgovornosti. Hvala lepa.
Najlepša hvala, gospa Tavčar, za te zaključke. Na ta način je uradni del konference končan. Seveda pa se naše druženje lahko nadaljuje v predverju in potem seveda tudi na vrhu hotela Intercontinental z prelepim pogledom na Ljubljano. So thank you very much. The official part of the conference is now over, but you're of course kindly invited to take part in mingling and networking afterwards here in the lobby and of course on the top from the terrace of the Intercontinental Hotel with a wonderful view of Ljubljana. So thank you very much and have a nice day. Hvala.
This recording was enabled with the contribution of the LIFE program of the European Union. Prispevek je bil omogočen s finančno podporo LIFE, finančnega mehanizma Evropske unije.